Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Jonathan Itzan. I teach here at the Department of Political Science and also at the graduate program in social and political thought. And Troy today is going to present the first, or rather the last, presentation in our speaker series that we have organized this semester. Troy is also a student in the graduate program in social and political thought. He's a PhD student, and he will be defending his dissertation next month. His work is on the Beers Cartel, and Troy is kind of a refugee from the Department of Economics. He has a BA and an MA degree in economics, at which point he decided that he wants to do real science, and he gravitated towards a broader attempt to understand capitalism. And what he is particularly interested in is in examining the power dimensions of capitalism from the microcosmic perspective of the corporation. So how do corporations actually convert the qualities of power into the quantities of power? And this is his work on the beers. And today he's going to take a diversion from the beers and focus on the history of General Electric. And he claims that this is the beginning of perhaps a new approach to what he calls accumulation studies. So I will give now the mic to Troy to begin his presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Jonathan, and thank you everyone for coming. This is very much the beginnings of a work in progress. I first became interested in General Electric and what I'm calling its enduring power over 5 years ago, but because I was working on my, what would become my dissertation, I kind of set it to the side, but just kind of kept returning to it, the question of how GE had maintained its power for so long really stuck with me. And as Jonathan mentioned, I'm really interested in how the qualities and the quantities move back and forth. So it's a quantitative fact that GE has remained powerful for over 90 years, and I'm interested to know what the qualitative dimensions of that are. Because this project is really in its early incarnation, even this presentation was kind of a work in progress, as I have probably over 30 graphs pertaining to GE in some shape or form, and as I was selecting from those graphs, I found new questions emerging. And as I pondered how to answer those questions, I would think, okay, do I have the data? If I had the data, I couldn't stop myself from going and constructing a new graph just to see if there was some new interesting story there. And I decided really that making graphs is one of my absolute favorite things. I saw another colleague of ours present recently. And after his presentation, one of the attendees remarked how marvelous it was that graphs contain so much information. And I thought that that was absolutely true. Maybe it seems obvious, but I don't think we stated enough that graphs are wonderful because they contain so much information. And I think, unfortunately, few people understand the work that goes into creating a quality graph. Finding out if the data you're looking for even exists. Once you know that it does exist, can you access it? Jonathan and those who work with him can speak to the struggles that we've undergone just to access data. These numbers are there, we want at them, and there are barriers in our way. And then once you have the data, turning it into something that is informative, because you can make a terrible graph or you can make an excellent informative graph, and everything in between. So a big part of this presentation will actually be on the technical aspect of how I made some of these graphs. I think that it's interesting. I hope that you will too. And I think it's ultimately a necessary story to tell, because we need to be frank and forthright with what these graphs can do, because they are powerful. But we should never let them mystify. They should always remain fully graspable for any of us to read, to understand, and to reconstruct, and then make graphs anew. So I begin with a claim that General Electric has demonstrated extraordinary longevity in the upper echelon of US corporations. So the empirical fact behind that claim is that General Electric has never left the top 10 when ranked by market capitalization. And this is narrow market capitalization, which is just equity. So share price times the outstanding number of shares. So since 1925, which is the earliest data I have that to rank, until 2013, which is the last year for which I've created a ranking, GE has never left the top 10. And that's a stunning fact, and only one other corporation matches that feat, and that corporation is Exxon. And I think Exxon being in that position is a little more understandable. It controls oil, and oil has been indispensable to the U.S. Political economy for that entire duration. So it's still a feat that it has kept its hand so firmly placed on the spigot for that period of time. But I think GE's endurance is a much more remarkable feat, given that it's a technology company. And it has remained in this upper echelon through the most tumultuous century of technological overturn that human history has ever seen. So the fact that it hasn't been swallowed up as new technologies have come about, I think is remarkable. So to make clear how remarkable its feat is, I wanted to compare some of the other corporations that were in the top 10 with it at different snapshots throughout its history. So in 1925, GE ranked third. Others in the top 10 included AT&T. We have Exxon, and there were two other oil companies. Pennsylvania Railroad was one of three railroad companies. And then we have Woolworth, which is a retailer. 1955, AT&T is still there. Exxon is still there. And now it's with three other oil companies. GM is there as it was in 1925. DuPont is there with one other chemical company. And now we have a different retailer. 1980, AT&T is gone. Exxon is still there. And it's there with five other oil companies. And Schlumberger is an oil field services company. So 70% of the top 10 is dominated by companies in some way connected with the oil industry. 2000, Exxon is the only oil company in the top 10. We now have Pfizer and one other pharmaceutical company. And we have Citigroup and one other financial intermediary, AIG. And then by 2013, Exxon is again the only oil field services company in the top 10. Microsoft is there with one other computing company, being Apple. Johnson & Johnson and one other consumer product conglomerate is there, Procter & Gamble. And Wells Fargo is the only financial intermediary. So throughout this 90-year history, almost 90-year history, the makeup of the top 10 has changed fairly dramatically, other than Exxon's continued presence. We've seen other oil companies rise and fall. And GE, as a technology company, is utterly unique in remaining in its place. So the empirical fact, GE's market capitalization has kept it in the top 10 of US corporations for at least 90 years, I think makes it indisputably a member of dominant capital, which is one of the central concepts of the capital as power framework. Rankings were constructed using data from the Center for Research on Security Prices, also known as CRISP. And they were measured and ranked using market equity, which I refer to as narrow market capitalization or dynamic market capitalization. So from CRISP, we have market equity. And the benefits of CRISP are that the data goes back to 1925, and daily values are also available. However, I've also taken data from the Wharton Research Data Service. Is that what it stands for? WRDS, which stands for words. And from words, you can add to equity data on long-term debt and retained earnings. And the advantages of word is that it also contains a lot of other variables. So this allows for a much more in-depth analysis than is available with CRISP, which is just restricted to equity values. So for example, you can get data on employment, net income, sales, assets, and others. So these are the two series where I've compared General Electric to the CRISP 25. So this is the largest 25 firms by market equity, and compared that to GE divided by the words 25. So this is the broader measure of capitalization, taking equity plus long-term debt plus retained earnings. You get a slightly different ranking. However, I think what's notable is that the dynamic remains largely the same. So although GE, relative to the words 25, does reach a larger differential later on in the 90s, the dynamic is largely the same. So Nitzan and Bickler have identified four elementary particles that comprise capitalization. The first is expected profits. The second is hype. The third is a risk coefficient. And the fourth is the so-called normal rate of return. These all compile into this formula. We won't go over it. But of course, what we're interested in is differential capitalization, which is perhaps the insight of the capital's power framework, that the struggle for accumulation is a redistributionary struggle. And the mechanism of that redistribution is capital. And capital is meaningful in differential comparison. So differential capital is the capitalization of any given firm relative to the per firm capitalization of dominant capital. If we assemble the elementary particles for the top and bottom, we get this mess. And I'm going to make a few simplifying assumptions. The first is that hype tends to one. The second is that GE and dominant capital have the same normal rate of return. And the third is that expected profits are equal to current profits. That allows me to perform this simplification so that differential capitalization is equal to differential profits times the inverse of differential risk. Because I can get data on capitalization, and I can get data on profits, I can create a coefficient for risk, and I've compiled that all here. So the bottom two series, the thin line, is the differential capital of GE. So that's GE relative to the words 25. So when that line is at one, that means GE is exactly the same size as the average firm in the words 25. When it's up at three, it's three times the size of the average firm. And within the CASP framework, we would say three times as powerful. The thick black line is differential earnings. So this compares GE's earnings to the average earnings of the words 25. And then the top line is differential risk. So this is GE's risk coefficient divided by the average risk of the words 25. And that I've constructed because I was able to make the bottom two series. So what we find is a closing between 1961 and 1981 of differential capital and differential earnings, which corresponds to increasing differential risk. So those who are evaluating GE are seeing it becoming riskier. So even though its differential earnings are trending slightly upwards over that 20-year period, its differential capital is trending sideways and slightly down. So in presenting this graph, I've glided over the matter of the denominator values. So what are the measures of dominant capital? Where did those measures come from? Now, just like sausages, these proxies are made. They are not discovered. And I'm going to show you a glimpse into how this sausage was made. Now, sausage can be delicious and nutritious. It can also contain lips and assholes. And knowing how it's made is one way to ensure you're getting one rather than the other. So I'm constructing a proxy for dominant capital. Dominant capital is an analytical concept, and it needs some empirical proxy. Nitzan and Bickler have defined dominant capital as the leading corporations and key government organs at the epicenter of the accumulation process. And so far, we have no consistent measure across government and corporate entities. The most widely used measures apply to publicly traded corporations. So we're already restricted in exactly what we can measure. The leading corporations can be defined as the largest firms by market capitalization. However, there's a question of what the dividing line is between dominant capital and non-dominant capital. And I think if we were able to somehow get above it and look down and see these things actually operating in the world, we would identify a very fuzzy boundary as firms are moving in and out. And the actual qualities that define being dominant or non-dominant are constantly shifting. However, we are stuck making some kind of hard divide. So here, I've constructed five different proxies for dominant capital. I've taken the capital value of GE and divided it by the average value of the 25 largest, the 50 largest, the 100 largest, the 200 largest, and the 400 largest firms. And as you would expect, GE's value relative to these increases as you include more and more firms, because you're including more and more firms that are smaller than GE. So the average is going down. And so the differential is increasing. And you'll notice that the left-hand axis is a logarithmic scale. So as we double the number of firms, the size of the differential increases by basically 1.5. And you probably notice that the contours match up very, very tightly. So there's a strong correlation between all of these series. In fact, the correlation of year-to-year growth ranges from 0.95 between the year-to-year growth of the words 25 and the year-to-year growth of the words 400 to 0.997. So the words 200 and the words 400, their change from year to year correlates at almost one. Now there are some differences between the two. Especially through the 80s and 90s, you'll notice that the contours change, where GE relative to the words 400 kind of has this movement. Relative to the words 25, it has kind of this movement. So comparing it to the different proxies for dominant capital does give you a different story. It's notable that GE relative to, these aren't words, these are all CRISP. CRISP 25, CRISP 50, CRISP 100, etc. So the GE relative to the CRISP 400, its absolute low was in 2009. Whereas relative to the CRISP 25, its absolute low was in 1969. And there are valid reasons for choosing one rather than the other. Now, having constructed these, I want to just go on a brief detour, which was something that came up to me as I was working on this, which is distribution within dominant capital. So I've created a subset of the 25 largest firms, and I've created a subset of the 400 largest firms. So that made me curious, What has happened between those two subsets over this period of time? Has capital tended to redistribute towards the largest 25 from the bottom 375, or has it gone the other direction? And this is what I found. So this is the CRISP 25, the average value of the CRISP 25, which is one of our proxies for dominant capital, relative to the average value of the CRISP 26 to 400, so the next 375 firms. And we see that in general, there's been a redistribution down within dominant capital. But I think some of the periods, when you look at them, become surprising. So for example, from 1925, straight through the start of the Great Depression, you see intense redistribution upward. There's no blip when the Depression happened. And it wasn't like during the boom times before the Depression, the CRISP 25 was faring poorly, and then the Depression served its interests. It did well all the way through. During wartime, it lost an average of 4.4% per annum. Then in the post-war period, it had another boom. Then starting in the early 60s until the mid-80s, there's a long trend downward. To me, this raises the possibility that there's an alternative periodization to the standard political stories that were told about post-war Keynesianism, neoliberalism, because we see some different movements in the redistribution among the powerful firms. But this was a detour. So back to the matter of dominant capital and the proxies that we're using for it. So first we used CRISP. We can also use words. So once again, here I'm comparing GE to my proxies using the words 25, 50, etc. Again, we see a strong correlation, although the correlation is slightly weaker than among the CRISP proxies. Again, there are some differences. And one of the more important issues with words, as I mentioned before, is that it has values for other variables. One of the comparisons we most want to make is with differential earnings, which I've already shown you for GE. Now, one of the problems with words is that some of the variables we might want to look at, those values aren't reported. So there are blanks, which can then throw off your measurement. So if I want to look at GE's differential income, I want to make sure that all of the firms I'm including in my proxy have that data. So if I filter out the firms that don't have data for income, is that going to mess up my proxy? Is it going to wildly change the dynamics of my proxy for dominant capital, which would then make that series questionable? So here I've compared a filtered and an unfiltered proxy. And you'll see that there is little difference. Again, they are strongly correlated. The correlation is 0.984 for the words 400 and 0.996 for the words 25. It does shift the differential values up slightly. However, the dynamics are overwhelmingly the same. And so I argue that the filtered version is suitable because it gives us access to other variables. And in this instance, I actually filtered out firms that didn't have values for net income, employment, sales, those three. And yet, the values for the differential are little changed. So I suggest this proxy remains suitable. So let's construct these differentials. We want to know differential capitalization. We want to know differential earnings. And an issue arises. So because this is on the logarithmic scale, that jut, and that's 1992, is much bigger even than it appears. The value for 1992 is almost four times the preceding value. The value for the GE relative to the Words earnings, Words 25 earnings, has disappeared completely. And that's because you can't graph a negative value on a logarithmic axis. So what has happened here? In 1992, GM lost a then record $23 billion. So if you calculate the average earnings of the Words 400 or the Words 25, GM overwhelms everything else and then makes GE look differentially enormous in the one case, and in the other case, you can't actually calculate it because it's a negative value. So the volatility of earnings can allow a single firm to overwhelm the benchmark. So the question I posed was, could I instead sort by earnings? So instead of sorting by capitalization, I sort the firms by earnings. So I'm changing the firms that are going to be included in my proxy. Am I going to get a different series? Is this going to change the picture, change the story of how GE has fared, because then it would make this new proxy questionable. So this is GE's capitalization relative to Words proxies for dominant capital. The thick black line is sorted for capitalization, and the thick gray line is sorted for earnings. And again, there's a strong correlation, suggesting that sorting the firms by earnings instead of capitalization and then selecting my proxies is appropriate. And it will remove this issue of firms with extremely low earnings for a year from throwing off the measure one way or the other. Here, I've compared GE's earnings relative to the Words proxies for dominant capital. Now, here it's had a stronger effect. So if we've sorted by earnings, instead of sorting by capitalization, and we now compare GE's earnings to the earnings for these two different proxies, we do get a somewhat strong effect by switching to a sort by earnings, but still not that large. What it does do is it shifts GE's differential earnings down. So if we sort by earnings, their differential earnings decrease. And it shifted its differential capitalization upward. And this has the effect of shifting the measure of differential risk down. So how much? So this is GE's risk relative to the Words 25. The thin line is sorted by capitalization. The thick line is sorted by earnings. And we see that there is a somewhat dramatic effect. However, the overall story, I say, is still more or less the same. There's still an increase during the period that we were demarcating 1961 to 1981. And post-81, we've seen a long-term decline in GE's differential risk. And we find the same thing if we compare GE to the Words 400 instead. So getting back to the original graph, the proxy I chose for this graph was the Words 25, filtered for blanks for net earnings, employment, and sales, and ranked by earnings. Now, I said there are reasons to pick either the 25 or the 400. One of the reasons I picked the 25 was because during the two decades of GE's differential lull, it trended sideways around one. So I thought it seemed appropriate to consider it relative to the group that it more or less rode the average with. And the second reason was that eventually I'm going to have to get more hands-on with the construction of this proxy. So far, I've been over-reliant on just taking the data from Words, performing reflexive calculations, a few error corrections, and then ranking them, and not actually looking at who the actual members are, because maybe there are reasons to question some of the data that I'm getting from Words. And it will be easier to look at 25 firms each year than it will be to look at 400 firms each year. So that may have seemed like a lot. And I promise I'm going to get to General Electric now, and then some slightly broader abstractions from General Electric after that technical sidetrack. Are there any questions about the proxy that I chose and how I constructed those proxies? What the meaning of the differential valuations are?
You have to speak to the mic.
Oh, yeah. Did you saw the last time?
Thank you.
Yes. So I was curious. It seemed to me at one point that while GE was doing quite well, what you, and I wish you can maybe explain this just a little bit further, they became a riskier, in the view of investors, they became riskier while they were doing better. And I'm curious, maybe you can elaborate just a little bit on that, because so I found that strange.
That I'll answer at the very end.
Okay.
So I have more to say about GE, although I don't specifically address that. So we can take that up again at the very end.
Can you hear me? Can you? Yes, I have a question. If you can just confirm that the differential risk is essentially a residual. So it is derived by dividing differential capitalization by differential earnings.
Yes.
Okay.
Question?
I'm not sure if this is relevant at this particular point in the presentation or not, and I came in about 10 minutes late. But one of the things that struck me, because I'm doing a dissertation also on General Electric, actually. I assume you are, and well, maybe not. Okay. Well, that's what I've been researching for the past couple of years is the General Electric company, actually, and specifically the relationship between the General Electric company and the state. That's the kind of focus, and where what the generative mechanism kind of is for neoliberalism, basically. And one thing that stuck out to me in your presentation, most of which I did not understand, I have to say, was the definition of dominant capital, right, which includes the state and the dominant firms.
Right.
I wonder if maybe you could elaborate theoretically on what the usefulness is of defining the state analytically as identical with capital when, at least from my research, one of the most interesting parts of the story of GE is that there are these incredible tensions and conflicts that emerge between GE and the state, or industrial firms that are restructuring in a financial way, and the state, especially during coming to a head in the 1970s, when extreme levels of, well, historically perhaps unprecedented in the US at least, levels of state autonomy led to an expansion of a new kind of regulatory structure, which I can get into. This may not be the time for that. But just basically, if you could, leading to a business mobilization in the 70s in the US that was kind of unprecedented since the 30s. So these historical dynamics seem to me to be almost invisible, or not almost invisible, actually invisible, if we define capital and the state as essentially the same thing. And I don't know, maybe there's an analytical utility to that I'm not aware of.
So I will get at that issue. The definition that I gave comes from Professor Knudsen and his writing partner. And the proxies that I used had to completely exclude any government agencies for practical reasons, and as you're suggesting, also you would say for theoretical reasons. And it's not a question I've had to directly confront, just because the measures aren't even there for me to debate whether this is a better proxy or not. So my proxy for dominant capital is entirely corporate based. So government is to the side, other than as they affect the measurement of these corporate values. Now, the issue you're raising, I think I will pose some, I will offer some evidence that will either challenge or support some of your claims in the subsequent section. So right now, I just wanted to deal with where I came up with my proxy and to justify that proxy more or less. And I was doing it in part to justify it to myself, because I wanted to make sure that the picture I was constructing of GE's differential dynamics was adequate and accurate. That its movement from the 1950s, from the late 1950s downward, and then post-1980s upward was an accurate picture. Were my proxies robust? And so I kind of put them to the test to determine which proxy might be best, and does changing the proxy change the story? And although changing the proxy does change the story somewhat, I think there's an interesting dynamic there between whether you compare GE to the 400 largest firms or the 25 largest firms. And we can get into that if you wish. So returning to the words 400 versus the words 25, one important difference is that from 1961 to 1981, and that's not what's shown here. What's shown here is just relative to the words 25. GE gained 2.2% per year relative to the words 25 in capitalization. And it lost 2% to the words 400. So if dominant capital is this much smaller subset, GE gained relative to them during what I'm calling its 20-year stagnation. But it lost relative to the words 400. So each proxy denotes a different envelope on dominant capital. And GE has a different relationship with each of them. What the particulars of that relationship are, qualitatively, are yet for me to explore. So this compares the crisp 25 and the crisp 400 to illustrate the qualitative differences of that relationship between the 25 largest firms or between the 400 largest firms. So again, this is the just market equity. It's not the broader definition of capitalization. So what we find is that between 61 and 81, relative to the crisp 25, GE lost 0.2% per year. So it more or less trended sideways. Relative to the crisp 400, which is the thick black line, it lost 1.5% per year. So during this stagnation, it was actually losing ground to this larger envelope. Now, the words 400, the words proxies also only went up to 2007, because I've only constructed them up to that point. CRISP, I have data all the way to 2013, and so while looking at GE relative to words, we saw a 1980s into early 2000s, mid-2000s boom. We can see, based on CRISP, that they have fared quite poorly since then. But it's notable that their decline preceded the most recent global financial crisis. So GE's 20-year stagnation. So its qualitative beginnings are in 1959. The US government accuses GE and Westinghouse of fixing the prices on electrical utility equipment, turbines, etc. Competitive bids between the two companies were coordinated. And so the government launched an antitrust lawsuit against GE. Now, there were immediate costs to the lawsuit. First, it cost the company a strategy that they had in place. They were coordinating with Westinghouse to rig the bids and more or less distribute the various contracts available. There were fines, substantial fines, hundreds of millions of dollars, very large at the time. And it came with increased oversight of the electrical equipment market. So they weren't operating quite as freely as they had been. In fact, GE was so integral into implementing electricity across the US that it had a long-term, almost regulatory role in the industry. Together with the US government, it functioned almost hand in glove. So what we're now seeing is a greater consequence than just those immediate costs, namely a worsening relationship with the US government. So during the war, GE had become an extremely important defense contractor, and it remained so after the war, and this had sent hundreds of millions of dollars into the company. And so this antitrust lawsuit signaled an important shift, and that's what I argue is the cause of the worsening risk. So even though GE's differential earnings are slightly trending up, its differential capitalization is trending sideways and down, because its relationship with the US government has worsened. And the decline in this relationship went both ways. GE's annual reports began to vociferously criticize the US government for failing to control inflation. And it identified myriad ways that government policies were failing business, with assertions, of course, that this meant they were failing America itself. So this leads me to the question of capital-state relations. And there are endless debates on what the relationship is between capital and the state. And I'm not interested in entering into those particular relationships because I think they're all in part a consequence from the standard approaches to capital. And I think the capital's power framework changes our understanding of what that relationship is. Namely, that there's a differential relationship between government and capital. So for part of its history, GE had one type of relationship with the US government. And for another part of its history, it had a different kind of relationship with the US government. And the meaning for that shift are complex. Further, there's the question of where this shift came from. And I suggest it came from two reasons, possibly two reasons. One, to favor a different business that was perhaps some form of competitor of GE's. And the second was to serve its national interest. And this may or may not have been the same thing. The US government may have shifted its support to a different business in conflict with GE because it was serving its own interest. Alternatively, there may have been happenstance differential beneficiaries of some government undertaking. And that pertains to one of the most important roles for government, which is protecting the game from the players. So the capitalist power perspective is that accumulation is a differential process. So the corporations are seeking to redistribute amongst themselves, and the means to do so are myriad, complex, and intertwined, and extend far beyond production. And sometimes their undertakings can threaten the very game that they're playing. So if the actions of corporations are broadly seen to be, say, corrupt, rather than delivering the goods that capitalism promises, then perhaps an uprising will destroy the game for everyone. So sometimes government has to step in to stop some particular course of action, like bid rigging, in order to say, look, we're fomenting the competitive process to ensure that we get the innovation that capitalism is here to deliver. And perhaps in the process, GE was one of the differential victims. Now, I also raised the issue of national interest, which raises to me the question of whether we exist in a mode of power or we live simultaneously within conflicting, overlapping, aligning modes of power. So Knitson and Bickler argue in favor of conceiving of modes of power rather than modes of production. And they say we are living in an age with capital as the dominant mode of power. And they have a long-term analysis that says the capitalist mode of power is ascendant. I claim that both states are so the current mode of power, the capitalist mode of power, is synonymous with the state of capital. And I say that there remains a potent and relevant state of sovereignty, that both states are functioning and they are mutually consequential. Now, to consider the distinction and the overlap between these two states, from their book, Nitzan and Bickler have this quip that there is little doubt that George Bush Jr. and his administration believe that they represented the national interest of the United States. But it is also fairly obvious that this same administration, whatever its formal leeway, could not have deviated too much from the underlying dictates of profit and accumulation. Altering it slightly, I think we can equally say there's little doubt that Jif Immelt, who's the CEO of GE, and his executives believed that they represented the accumulation interests of General Electric. But it is also fairly obvious that this same board, whatever its formal leeway, could not have deviated too much from the underlying dictates of US national interest. So much like the cities in China Mieville's The City and the City, these two states can and will operate within the same space. In fact, I think much that's interesting within capitalist societies are where these two interests are negotiated. The logic of capital and the logic of national interest are neither mutually exclusive nor wholly aligned. Rather, there's a pantheon of functionaries, from lawyers to lobbyists, whose job is devoted to bringing them into alignment. And I agree with Nitzan and Bickler that over the long term, the logic of capital and accumulation is slowly becoming dominant. However, the state of sovereignty shouldn't be counted out just yet. It remains an incredibly potent accelerator and decelerator on accumulation. I argue that GE found itself on the losing end of the negotiation between accumulation and national interest during the 1960s and 70s. Although it managed to climb out of those doldrums, the recent financial crisis appears to have reverted it back to its differential level of that era. Globalization means GE is much less reliant on the US. However, it remains rooted there and continues to negotiate its relationship with the government, as all corporations must. Thank you.
Thank you, Troy. Just to return to some of the issues I was trying to raise before,
The kind of qualitative analysis that you brought in there in the second part was interesting, and I would agree with most of it. There's certain key dimensions of it that I think you leave out, which is encouraged in part by the methodology that you're using, and some of the theoretical problematics that you've engaged with, the theoretical problematic that you've elaborated. First, you mentioned that in the second half, you now argue, unlike in the first half, that there is a differential relationship between the state and capital, meaning that the state and capital cannot be the same thing because they are two externally related discrete entities, which is a completely different definition of the state than what you employed in the first half, as far as I understand it. I would agree with that. I think that that just is the same kind of idea that I would refer to as relative autonomy. It seems to me just kind of a different language for a similar kind of conceptual idea. And so what then becomes for me the interesting object of historical analysis, especially when we are referring to a company, a huge diversified industrial firm that also financialized over the 1960s, 70s, and 80s, slowly and in different kind of ways, including internal reorganization, is the way in which this differential relationship between state power and this corporate entity shifted, and why. You mentioned the breakup of the Great Electrical Conspiracy in 1961. Where GE and Westinghouse were essentially fixing prices on Tennessee Valley Authority contracts. Now, what's interesting about this to me is that in the previous era, where I would argue that corporate command and control structures were dominated by banks, whereas after World War II, they became dominated by professional managers. There was a kind of loosening of bank-centered economic networks over the 1930s, and in the World War II period, kind of de facto nationalization. After the war, huge diversified firms are now dominated by managers. In the previous era, before this kind of managerial moment when the great electrical conspiracy was broken up by the U.S. government. The U.S. state actually promoted very, very similar kinds of monopolistic arrangements to the one that they broke up in 1961. They told GE to form, they asked GE and Westinghouse to form the Patent Control Board, which was literally an institution that allowed them to hear any applications for new patents. And if they already had those patents, if they argued that those patents conflicted with existing patents held by GE or Westinghouse, those patents wouldn't be granted. Or if they did not contradict existing patents, they were given privileged authority to purchase them. So it was essentially allowing this kind of system of monopolistic self-regulation, which you described pretty accurately as kind of these firms engaging in state regulation. So from that moment, when the state goes to this kind of New Deal expansion, they bring in these executives to run the state institutions that are at that moment pretty weak. They actually tell these executives to come in and run the NRA, the National Recovery Administration, which was actually designed in part by Gerard Swope, who was a GE executive. And they bring him into the state to run this. So World War II, the Wartime Production Board, again, the president of GE, Charles Wilson, becomes the vice chairman of the Wartime Production Board, right? So they bring him into the state. And then after the war, they're throwing these guys in jail for doing the exact same thing. So you argue this could happen for two reasons. Number one, the state favors a different business, which is not the case, because there was no other competitor that could do what GE had done and had grown in the ways that it did over World War II. The second thing you argue is U.S. national interests. Well, that's just kind of an empty phrase. I mean, the U.S. national interest is whatever the government defines it to be. The more interesting historical question is why the national interest becomes what it is, according to the state at a given moment. And what I would argue had gone on over this period that I just kind of laid out far too briefly is an institutional development of the state, right? Where the state now has a much more capacity to regulate capital than it did in the prior era. So state autonomy then is a function in part of its institutional capacity to actually have an internal dynamism that is separate from, or at least relatively autonomous from, corporate bureaucratic management. Bureaucratized kind of production networks, right, in the corporate side. So I think that that's an important dimension that's being left out, partly because of the vagueness of your theoretical framework in some ways, but also because of the excessive quantitative focus, which is allowing us to conduct this assessment without really looking at the mechanics, the qualitative mechanisms that are generating and reproducing these relations practically over time. And just one more final point. I'm sorry I've gone on for too long. Just one more final thing I'd like to bring up. You said at the very end when you were talking about, quoting Knudsen and Bichler, something I would completely agree with, again, defining what I would say is relative autonomy in relation to the Bush administration and the relative autonomy of the state from accumulation. You mentioned as well, interestingly, that Jeff Immelt and the GE executives also are relatively autonomous in this inverse kind of way from the state, in that they can't get too far away from what's defined as a national interest. What's interesting about this to me is that you neglect, importantly, this dimension of corporate reorganization, institutional restructuring, and kind of historical evolution of the actual materiality, the historical materiality and organizational form of the corporation that saw a shift in the relations of power within the command and control structure. So it's not just between Jeff Immelt and GEC executives and the state, defined as some homogenous thing. There are these complex interpenetrations, the specific state institutions that it relates to shift. The hierarchy of state apparatuses changes. Which state apparatuses are the most significant, most powerful in setting policy changes. Likewise, on the corporate side, we have a shift from bank control to kind of de facto nationalization to managerial control. And then since the 1970s, increasingly investor power and financial discipline over management. So you mentioned the board of directors as the kind of central, from what I gather, this kind of central command post of the corporation. But actually, the board of directors was a kind of backwater up until relatively recently, when internal executives, GE's board has long been composed predominantly of external executives from other companies and former state officials and so on and so forth. Very few internal GE executives actually on the board. As of this moment, the only GE executive is Jeff Immelt. it's been the management that was in charge, and they basically controlled the board. The internal management basically kind of subordinated the board, which is supposed to be the kind of governance link with the investment community. Only with the rise of investor power since the 1970s has the board again become a kind of more significant component of the corporate command and control structure. So all of these qualitative power dynamics are left out in terms of understanding where neoliberalism comes from, what neoliberalism is, what is financialization, what has been the pattern of global economic integration. All of these things are missed. Even though I agree with the very few empirical qualitative comments you made, they don't tell us very much. We have to have a much more in-depth historical analysis, I think.
The part you missed was me saying, like, this is very much preliminary work, which is the reason why it's quantitative. And I'm very much starting purposefully with the quantitative analysis, because the things you say I miss, you're calling for a much more detailed qualitative analysis. I completely agree. There's much more to go on in here. I found much of what you said extremely interesting. But then at the very end, in your call for me to do much more qualitatively, you threw out a lot of the jargon that is exactly what I'm trying to avoid. I want to talk about GE's accumulation without recourse to neoliberalism, which is a term that I think has long outlived its usefulness, without the term financialization, which means more or less nothing, unless we define a specific qualitative process. I'm beginning with the quantities of GE's differential accumulation, which, using the capitalist power framework, I say is the literal bottom line. This is what they want to achieve. They want to differentially accumulate. And so the movement of that differential accumulation gives me a map to the shifts in GE's power. Now, Jonathan noted in the introduction that what I'm interested in is how the qualities and the quantities of power translate into one another. But for power to be meaningful within the capitalist system, it has to eventually become quantitative. You can talk about all of the power that exists. If it doesn't turn up somewhere in the quantities, it's ultimately meaningless as far as capitalists are concerned. Now, one of the reasons why I think GE is interesting is for the exact reason that you're saying, and that their board was relatively powerless, and this was largely because direct owners never had much control over GE relative to a lot of other corporations, which I think makes GE in some ways, at least at one time, a much more unique corporation, in that it could somewhat divert from this singularly minded bottom line interest in differentially accumulating. They could pursue other undertakings. And when you read their annual reports, you see some of these alternative interests at play. So GE refers to people's capitalism. Their reports are touting how many shareholders they have. They took great pride in how widely their shares were distributed. Their early reports were 20 pages, and probably a quarter of them were devoted to the various programs that they offered to their workers. So they had a view of themselves as much more of a sort of social caretaker. What now, the jargon of a triple bottom line, I think in a lot of ways early GE had that as part of their interest. They really saw their role as something of a social caretaker. During the Great Depression, they talked about the programs that they introduced to support the workers that they were laying off. Now, on the one hand, this is propaganda. They're selling themselves. But I do think there's an element of truth to it, because GE is not as beholden to the ongoing dictates of differential accumulation.
Can I ask very briefly?
I have a comment maybe before you respond, because I think that there is possibly a serious misunderstanding here. It seems to me that you are conflating two different dualities, the duality between governments and corporations and the duality between state and capital. I don't think anybody in his right mind would say that governments and corporations are the same entities. And I think that in all of your commentary, you spoke about governments and corporations. So in a way, you are bursting into an open door. You cannot take a department or a ministry or the government as a whole and say that it is the same as the corporation, and nobody would say that be accepted as reasonable. The duality between state and capital is a different story altogether, because these are very abstract entities. And the reason why we thought that it is worthy of consideration, whether we should keep that duality or not, is because the accumulation process is, in our opinion, quite impossible without state institutions and state processes. So that's an antithesis, A, to the liberal view that somehow the economy is separate from politics, and also to the capitalist perspective of Marx, that somehow there is expanded reproduction that generates value and surplus value and an accumulation that is assisted from the outside by state institutions that safeguard the system in some way, but other than that, is anchored in the economy. We felt that this is brought to the 21st century is creating an upside down pyramid. In other words, you put everything on the sort of little footprint of production, and then the rest of the pyramid is all sorts of power distortions, quote unquote. And that's quite unacceptable, to base an entire theory on distortion. So the idea is that every dollar of capitalization, every dollar of profit, every movement in risk is completely imprinted by power relations of society. In other words, by what we thought to call the state of capital. So that fusion is happening at a much higher abstract level, whereas you are talking about organizations, and nobody disputes that organizations of government and organizations of capital are different. We are talking about the larger logic of what actually constitutes accumulation. And here, these two categories become really very fuzzy. So I just wanted to clarify that, so we're not really barking up the wrong tree.
Go ahead. Yeah, I can wait. Please go. Thank you very much, Troy. And as you know, I'm a total outsider in this and neophyte. But I'm interested in what's going on now. My understanding is that that GE has. Let me back up a little bit. There's this guy who's written this book called Other People's Money. And he makes the thesis, I haven't finished reading the book, that which was first identified by another fellow in 2007, that the shift by corporations to finance the world of finance from the world of doing real things like providing services and goods is sort of one of the end games of capitalism, that the process as we know it can't survive if that were to continue. Something like that. It's an end game in any case. But my understanding is, in that context, that GE has just recently, I think, gone out of the finance business altogether and back into the technologies. So isn't that sort of interesting? Like, what's going on here?
No, I think it is interesting. They're not out of the finance game altogether. Their 2014 report says they're seeking to make finance no more than 25%, the source of no more than 25% of their earnings, and it's currently over 40%. I'm not sure what its peak share was. And I think it is interesting, and I think it's in keeping with this still, I think, somewhat inexplicable durability of GE. If we go back and we look at GE relative to the CRSP 25 and the CRSP 400, we see that the most recent crisis, and actually somewhat preceding the most recent crisis, their differential decline brought them more or less back down to the relative level that they were during their doldrums, which was slightly below the level that they were at before. And I think part of this is due to them butting up against the upper end of accumulatory possibilities. There's just nowhere really for them to go. And I think they saw moving into financial intermediation as a means of breaking through this envelope. And for a while, it looked like it was working. And then when they found themselves in the worst crisis of their existence with the financial crisis, I think a recalculation showed that this was not the business that they wanted to be in. One of the things that had me wondering was if they're foreseeing regulation in that industry that they don't want to come their way. Their movement out of that, if I had money invested in that industry and I saw GE departing, it would give me serious thought that it might be worth departing
exactly,
also.
Exactly, but my concern is at a higher, if you like, a more broad level, is it saying something about capitalism as a whole? If these guys have figured it out, just the way the Rockefellers went out of oil, I mean, the world is still reeling from that. How can the Rockefellers not be in oil? Now, GE's doing a major shift. Is it telling us something bigger?
They're returning, though, to their technological...
Yeah, but out of default, maybe the default, you don't know what else to do. You know, maybe.
Yeah, I don't know.
Okay, so I'm just going to very briefly just make a couple of comments just to reply to what you said. First of all, you mentioned that you think GE is an exception to the general rule in terms of the command and control structures shifting from managerialism into the investor capitalism. That's definitely not true. It conforms exactly with the general trends and, in fact, has tended to be the vanguard of each of these transformations at the very front of it. And I was kind of surprised that you then drew on for the managerial period the kind of thesis of the soulful corporation, which was discredited propaganda already in the 1960s, where corporations led by managers are somehow less dependent on the profit motive. They're able to fulfill a broader social function. The managerial class is ending capitalism. Somehow this is coming from Galbraith and all these other people. It's been very, very clearly empirically refuted. Managerial-led firms are just as motivated by the profit motive and geared toward profit maximization as other firms, as I'm sure probably most people would agree. But that's just empirically. I mean, Edward Herman's 1981 study, Corporate Control, Corporate Power.
You're making a generalization, which is moving in the exact opposite direction of what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to differentiate GE. You're saying that this thesis has been discredited, but what I'm saying is, look, here's what I think is clear evidence of this exact thing. And I could see very well that Galbraith looked at that and he did the exact opposite. He said, well, look here, let's extrapolate from that. This is where capital as a whole is going, where what I'm interested in is the differential qualities of this process.
But to be fair, there's just no evidence that they were not motivated by profit maximization at any point. In fact, there's a lot of evidence that they continue to be. That's all I'm saying. So you want to talk about a broader social function, then there's just no evidence for that. The firm as a strategic hierarchy that engages externally with markets and is shaped by them is essentially strategically motivated by the desire to maximize profits in terms of satisficing and that sort of language. That
anything about it?
Maximum profits available under the current economic conditions. But if I could just,
do you know anything about the maximum? I'm just wondering, you are describing
it. Okay, so you're aware of the theory, this kind of a theoretical conception that came around in the 1970s of satisficing behavior?
Yeah, I'm aware of
it,
but
I'm not
I'm not trying to find out citations here. I'm just wondering if you have a clear idea of what maximum profit is. For example, if GE made $13 billion in net profit, was this the maximum or not? Do you know anything about that?
Okay, so satisficing refers to the process by which corporate rulers drive to produce the maximum profits, that their strategic orientation is toward producing the most profits they can. So whether they actually achieve some objective maximum or not isn't exactly the issue. It's about what the subjective orientation of the strategic imperative is, which is to maximize profit to the extent possible.
Well, we know from the 1930s onwards that corporations tell us that they're not trying to maximize profit.
They tell us that.
No, they tell us that they're not.
Okay, but that's...
So I mean, from the studies of Hull and Hitch in the 1930s, corporations are constantly telling us of all sorts of
strategies that they are following, and none of them actually is about maximizing profit. So I'm just wondering, I have no problem with you accepting the idea of profit maximization, but you shouldn't really impose it on everybody else without being able to tell us what maximum profit is.
Okay, so let me just, I'll address this quickly, but there's a couple other points I wanted to make, which I don't want to take up too much time here. Maybe other people have things they'd like to say. But the question for me was about this distinction between the theory of the soulful corporation, which did indeed come out in the 1930s in the kind of managerialist literature beginning with Berlin Means, and the idea that with managerial power, that corporations were less dependent on the profit motive than they had been before. And there's just no empirical evidence that's been persuasive, despite the proclamations of managers to serve a higher social function, that that's actually been the case. And in fact, in detailed studies with corporate managers themselves, going back to the 1950s, responded with kind of bemusement that some social scientists had come up with ideas that profit was no longer the main guiding principle of business. That's all I'm talking about. And no, if you want to disagree with me empirically, that's fine.
But I think that the problem is here that we are engaged in a dialogue, and the way that you're presenting your opinion as if there is one or two possibilities. Maybe there are other possibilities. I don't think that Troy is espousing here, and he should probably speak for himself, the idea of soulful corporations at all. We are talking here about differential profitability, which is very much a very powerful imposition on the logic of capital. It is about profit, but it's not about profit maximization, and there's a huge, huge difference between them. So for you, the alternative for profit maximization is sales maximization or soulful corporations, but I don't think this is the direction that Troy is moving. And so you are making all sorts of assumptions on what Troy is trying to achieve. And I think that
that's not the case, though, Professor. I'm sorry, but he literally just referred to people's capitalism and so on. That's what I was exactly talking about.
GE referring to people's capitalism, and I'm saying that that has some qualitative meaning in the actions that GE undertook.
Capitalism? I mean, that's what I'm asking. Are we talking about something that's historically effective or something that's just ideological rhetoric? And that's a question.
I think that that's a false dichotomy.
Well, then we can't.
Ideology is just one more of those terms that I want to escape. I want to look at the actual function. I want to look at what they say. I want to look at what they did. And I want to leave behind these overarching terms that have burdened political economy for the last 50 years.
All right. I would like to move on to two more points. But to be fair, you've just invented a whole new set of jargon-laden terms that are...
Right.
So then,
it gives us a new way of looking at things, a new way of understanding things.
All right, but whether or not ideology is just some overarching category, if it pertains to literally philosophically definable categories like human consciousness, sociality, and so on and such forth, is, to me, a settled issue. But it's not just some abstract thing. It's a clearly definable, philosophically grounded category. It's well established in the social sciences for good reason. But just to comment then, I guess, on just one more point. Professor Knitson, thank you very much, by the way, for your correction, because I was conflating indeed and not being very clear in differentiating between institutional power and class or what I would call class power, what you refer to as capital, and the difference between the relationship between organizational forms and the relationship between capital and the state, in other words. Indeed, I would say that those are different questions. However, the relationship between the state and capital not being external, by the way, I would not say that, but is still a relevant problematic in the sense that the regulatory structures that shifted, that went through such a profound shift in the 1960s and 70s did indeed indicate a greater degree of state autonomy from capital as a whole, partly as a function of its institutional capacities, which had expanded, partly as a result of the organizational power of oppositional elements in U.S. society, namely labor unions at that time. But the state had shifted from industry-specific regulatory model to a kind of general form of social regulation, which actually helped solidify capitalist organizations as a kind of opposition to this kind of expanding state autonomy and redefining the regulatory terrain in this way, actually helped to mobilize those organizations. So you're right that it's a different question. It's a different level of analysis, I should say, and it's wrong to conflate them. But I just thought that I think you could still apply the category of relative autonomy at the level of institutional power also. And then just one last thing, when you mentioned about the definancialization of GE, indeed it is because of the regulatory issues. I mean, the Financial Services Oversight Committee, which came out of Dodd-Frank, did indeed tell GE that they were going to regulate them as a systemically important financial institution, and the Treasury Department gave them a deadline to divest from the financial sector, or else have to face increased capitalization requirements, disclosure requirements, and so on. And they've publicly said repeatedly in the press, Jeff Immelt and others, that the reason why they're divesting is to avoid these regulatory burdens.
Comment? No. Okay. Any other questions, please?
Hi. Even though I have no knowledge whatsoever what just happened here in terms of GE per se, I'm kind of more interested about the two concepts that you brought up about state of capital and state of sovereignty, and their kind of coexistence and the relationship between the two. I was just wondering if you could kind of expand a little bit more on their relationship and if they conflict with each other, which one has more power over the other?
So I deal with this kind of interpretation of the capitalist power framework much more extensively in one of the chapters of my dissertation as it pertains to the De Beers cartel. And like Professor Knudsen said, I'm very interested in looking at kind of the narrow actions of corporations and trying to understand why they took certain courses of actions rather than others. I take it as a given that accumulation is the constant bottom line. But the pursuit for differential accumulation is not determinate. It doesn't say this is the absolute course of action that must be taken. There are always certain choices that can be made. And that's the reason why I think at times we need to take seriously when a corporation says, we are doing this to serve the national interest. Sometimes, certainly, it's to try to confound and put blinders on. But when the choice needs to be made between one course of action or another, when the Oppenheimer family kind of declares that it is functioning in the interest of the state of South Africa, I think we should take that seriously. Does that mean that's the only thing that's going on? Absolutely not. But I do think in that one instance, the state of sovereignty and the loyalty that the family feels towards the state, the fact that De Beers remains grounded in South Africa, that it can't fully step aside from the system of sovereign organization, means that it has to function in accordance with those two logics. Now, those two logics, again, they don't determine a set specific course of action. They're constantly informing the negotiation between the two. And these can lead to very divergent courses of action. So in the case of De Beers, the US took it as in their national interest to launch an antitrust lawsuit against De Beers. The UK took it as in their national interest to more or less allow De Beers to regulate the flow of diamonds during World War II. And despite the fact that the US and the UK were allies, they both took very converse courses of action that had important consequences for the accumulation of De Beers. And I thought I couldn't make sense of everything that was going on without having the state of sovereignty as something that continued to function within the process of accumulation.
Yes, other questions, please? Go ahead.
Just at the beginning of your presentation, when you were talking about the number of large corporations according to market capitalization in 1925, how so few of them are, is it just GE remains today?
Exxon.
Oh, Exxon, okay. It struck me that in Germany, the situation is quite different, where you have, like in 1925, a lot of the large players are still the large players today. And I just thought, like, why is that significant? I don't know why.
I'm not necessarily saying that the other members of the top 10 have disappeared or ceased to exist. I'm not trying to prove or disprove Marshall or Schumpeter claiming that, you know, eventually the trees get so big that they die. These firms have faced all kinds of fates, and some of them names have changed and they've merged, and so they've seemed to disappear, but they haven't really. But GE's endurance, as you know, a clearly identifiable entity in there, is what kind of caught my interest and made me look at them more deeply.
So was it? I guess what I'm getting at is what is the significance of that? Like that it has remained a sort of dominant corporation for so long. Now I do think, according to the historical record, like it has changed. Like even though it's GE, it has changed. It was basically a financial services company before the crisis. Has changed substantially, and then there's interesting links between the state. I forget what role Jeff Immelt had in the Obama administration.
Jobs Commission.
Okay.
Yeah. Jobs
Commission. Okay. So, I can see how it's an interesting company to look at, but I just felt in this presentation you didn't
clearly
describe why you were looking at it, and then we were dealing with some of the
tentatively. I think it's diffuse ownership. I think the point raised that it was a very management-controlled corporation, and the fact that allowed it. So it could never completely turn away from accumulation. It could never say, you know, we're big enough. We don't need to get any bigger. You just can't do that and remain a functioning corporation. But I do think it was not as beholden to the increasing demand for returns on a fairly short time frame. I think that from its early history, at least until the 70s, there was a technotopianism that was an actual functioning interest. And again, it had to be brought into alignment with the accumulatory interest. But when there are choices to be made among different courses of action, the course of action that would be technologically innovative, I think, was the course of action that they pursued. Now, there's certainly a propagandistic element. The 1967 World Fair, when they had Progress Land, showing all of the great things that they're offering. But this is why I think that, not that ideology is a bankrupt concept, but I think that it's not abstract enough. It just totally obscures the fact that we can take GE's celebration of its own innovation and say, well, that's just purely ideological rhetoric. I think we need to dissemble it and understand it through new abstractions that allow us to see it both as rhetoric and as materially serviceable.
Any other question? We have another question. First, as you would expect, I completely agree with the starting point, namely that we have to look at differential measures of accumulation to first clarify in our mind what is the periodicity of GE or of any other corporation. In other words, what is really important? And if what is really important is accumulation, we have to start with the quantities of accumulation as you have done. So I think we are starting from the same premise. One thing I think, if you are to continue and expand that, one thing you probably would like to do is maybe enrich it a little bit. One way of enriching it is looking at the differential performance, not just relative to the big firms, but relative to, you know, larger aggregates and maybe the average, because, you know, big firms themselves have grown tremendously over that period relative to the average. So that could be quite misleading if we just look at that picture and see the GE has sort of tumbled over the past maybe 20 years. It hasn't tumbled. It tumbled relative to the very, very, very large corporations. So to put it in a larger context, maybe put it also in an international context relative to firms in other countries. So that's one thing. The other thing is, and that might be very, very important and related to some of the other questions that were raised, because your risk measure is residual. So you are defining capitalization, differential capitalization as differential earnings times the inverse of differential risk, and then you basically compute differential risk by dividing differential capitalization by differential profit. So that is true by definition. The interesting thing is to have secondary indices to see if that derivative index actually is reflecting the volatility of earnings of GE. So I did with Shimshon some preliminary work in the past on that. We suggested that the earnings of GE are fantastically stable. And that is something that is worthy of examination because it's a conglomerate and it is constantly able to shift in and out from sectors to balance its portfolio in a way that stabilizes its earnings. And that greater stability, of course, increases capitalization. So this is something that is worthy of, I think, further examination because risk could be incredibly important over the medium term. Maybe not over the very, very long term. If you take a century, maybe it's less important. But if you take a period of a generation, like 20 years or even two generations, 40 years, it could be very significant. So that's worthy of further investigation, I think. Thanks.
All right. Other questions?
So thank you very much, Troy, for a very stimulating